Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship. We've got a couple extra singers with us this morning to kind of fill us out. Please join us in the first song, So Will I.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. No point of reference, you spoke to the dark, pressed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, failures disappear. We are
Good morning, First Lutheran Church, and welcome to worship. Thanks to the Bump family for starting us off with a wonderful piece from their home. Remember, they're still isolating for another week, but thankfully they have all been safe at home this week, and it was so great to see the kids as well. Keep watching. You will see them again later in our service. There are a few announcements I want to bring to your attention as our service continues, the first of which is this big thing I have up here on the altar. This is our wheel that we are trying to create as our congregational art project. This is the beginnings of it. As you see, we've got a hula hoop, and we have put some fabric around it and some yarn and some string, and now it is just awaiting your prayer requests. If you did not have a chance to catch the video that I posted on Facebook the other day, please go to our Facebook page after worship and check it out. You'll understand a little bit more about this project. We are going to take fabric with your prayers written on it and weave it all the way out. So when we are finished with our sermon series, we will have a beautiful piece of art, kind of looking like this, that we will be able to hang and you will be able to see once we get back in the building. And we will be able to remember how our prayers were woven together during this time when we've been isolating at home and we are separate from one another. So you need to email me your prayer requests so we can start building our wheel. Three things. Name something that has unraveled in your life at some point. It doesn't just have to be this past year or something that's unraveling right now. Name a plan that has fallen apart or a time when you felt unraveled. I know many of us have made plans, especially this past year, that have fallen apart or unraveled for us. So let us know about that. That can be part of our prayer wheel. Or simply write me a short prayer. Dear God, please weave something of your choosing into my life. You know, please weave love. Please weave peace. Something like that. Send those to me in an email. You can send it through Facebook Messenger. And we will love to get started on our art project. And hopefully in a couple weeks, we can update you with what it looks like. As you can also see, the other side of our altar, it is Communion Sunday. So if you haven't yet gotten your supplies for communion later in the service, please take a moment at some point to grab those, to have those ready for later in our service. And also be sure that you check back on Thursday's e-news. We have two book studies that are upcoming in several weeks that we would love for you to participate in. You can purchase your book to be delivered to your home, and you can join us on Zoom for those two book studies, but you got to check them out on the e-news that came out on Thursday. If you need any information about any of these things, please don't hesitate to send me an email and ask questions. I'll be sure to help you out with any of those things. Those are all the announcements that I wanted to highlight today, and so please join me in our words for centering today as we are continuing this unraveling series. We are looking at when plans for our children fall apart, when we have dreams for our children. So we have words today that fit this theme. Please join me. When you dream, what do you dream of?
We dream of
children who know love and churches with open hearts. We dream of rest and sunny days. When you dream, what do you dream of?
We dream of peace without walls and equality for all people.
When you dream, what do you dream of? We dream of milk and honey, food on tables, and an end to suffering. We dream of the Church of Jesus Christ serving all God's people. People of God, this morning, we dream together. This morning, we worship together. For there is nothing on heaven or on earth strong enough to unravel God's dreams for us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we do not know the plans you have for us. We do not know, so we set aside money for days to come. We keep our fingers crossed and try to control the world around us, having faith in the midst of uncertainty has never been easy for us. Forgive us for the moments when we refuse to trust you. Strengthen us so that when life unravels, we are strong enough to turn to you. That is our prayer of faith. Amen. Let us now join again with the Bumps in singing another song.
Please join us in singing Thy Will.
At this point in the service, this is my time with the kids. This is my time where you pop your heads up from the seats, you stop coloring whatever you're working on, you come running forward, You come running down all the aisles. You come forward and you sit with me on these stairs. I want you to remember that. We're going to do that again soon, I really hope. You gather around me, and I always have questions. So, kids, this is our time together. So gather a little closer. Wish I could see your cute faces, but I know that you're there. I know that you're watching, and I want you to know that your church misses you, and we love you so much. So I want to ask you today, like I always do, I've got questions. I want to ask about your family. Do you have any siblings, a brother or a sister? Maybe one of you has a twin brother or sister. I wonder about your parents. I wonder if you have one parent or two parents, or if you've got step parents that you have in your life. I wonder if you have cousins that you get to visit on occasion and play with. And I wonder about your grandparents. Do you have a grandmother or a grandfather that you get to climb up in their lap and they get to tickle you or tell stories or play with you? I wonder about your family. But I bet if you were here and I asked each of you about your family, every family would be different. Everybody has a different type of family. There's no family that looks the exact same. There are different numbers of siblings and cousins and aunts and uncles and grandparents and step parents and half brothers and sisters and siblings. So I want you to think about all the different ways a family can come together, all the different ways that a family can look. And it doesn't matter what they look like because they're all family. And then I want you to think about how sometimes God brings us with people that we aren't related to. And I think about this church. I think about the people that sit here in these chairs and how I consider them a part of my family. And I want you to think about that too. If you were here, I'd tell you to stand up and look at all your brothers and sisters in Christ. All of your siblings out here, we are all related. We are all a part of God's family. How cool is that? God is our parent, and God created all of us to love and live together in community as family. So even though we aren't biologically related, God brings us together to care for each other and to love one another. So I want you to think about families this week and all the different ways that families can appear. But remember your church family and all your siblings in Christ that are missing you. And one day we will be able to have a wonderful reunion. So let us pray before our service continues. Good and gracious God, thank you for our families and all the different ways families are created. You give us people to love and who love us as we grow. Help us to care for your greater family, those people we are connected to through your church and those who never come through these walls that are outside in this community. Remind us that we are all siblings in Christ together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks so much, kids, for giving me a little bit of your time today. It meant so much. And now we have a reading today from Exodus. Pharaoh issued a general order to all his people. Every boy that is born, drown him in the Nile, but let the girls live. A man from the family of Levi married a Levite woman. The woman became pregnant and had a son. She saw there was something special about him and hid him. She hid him for 3 months. When she couldn't hide him any longer, she got a little basket boat made of papyrus, waterproofed it with tar and pitch, and placed the child in it. Then she set it afloat in the reeds at the edge of the Nile. The baby's older sister found herself a vantage point a little way off and watched to see what would happen. Pharaoh's daughter came down to the Nile to bathe. Her maidens strolled on the bank. She saw the basket boat floating in the reeds and sent her maid to get it. She opened it and saw the child, a baby, crying. Her heart went out to him, and she said, "This must be one of the Hebrew babies." Then his sister was before her. "Do you want me to go and get a nursing mother from the Hebrews so she can nurse the baby for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said, "Yes, go." The girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter told her, "Take this baby and nurse him for me. I'll pay you." The woman took the child and nursed him. After the child was weaned, she presented him to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her son. She named him Moses, saying, "I pulled him out of the water." Here ends our reading for today. A hero. I want you to think about that term. A hero can be a person who completes a courageous act that will benefit many, while also endangering their own life sometimes. They make a conscientious decision to do what they think is right, often going against the majority opinion. Oskar Schindler is just such a hero. He was a German industrialist and a member of the Nazi Party who, through cunning and courage, is credited with saving the lives of over 1,200 Jews during the Holocaust. But what makes the story of Oskar Schindler so fascinating is that he is not a saint. He cheated on his wife, he drank excessively, and he spied for the counterintelligence arm of the German military in Czechoslovakia. But the personalities and characteristics of human beings can't be spliced. Sometimes character flaws such as hubris can also lead to great achievements through a willingness to attempt something most people never would. Oskar's espionage activities on behalf of Germany, while regrettable to enemies of Germany, later put him in a position to save many lives. He tried to do everything in his power to defeat the system by employing Jews in his enamelware and ammunition factories in occupied Poland. And although initially motivated by profit, he ended up saving the lives of his Jewish employees. And through it all, he came to show extraordinary initiative, tenacity, dedication, and courage. Did you note the key word that makes someone a hero? Courage. There are two definitions of this word, and both are worth mentioning. The first is the ability to do something that frightens someone, while the second definition is strength in the face of pain or grief. So think about those two definitions. And for anyone who knows the whole story of Oskar Schindler, he did something that was absolutely frightening while also having strength in the face of enormous pain and grief around him. He was truly a remarkable gentleman. This is just one such story from modern times about someone who had the courage to do something that seemed impossible. We can find many more stories of courage within the pages of our own Bible. Think about Daniel as he was facing the lions. Courage. Joseph, when he was being sold by his brothers into slavery and taken to a faraway place to live. Courage. Esther, Queen Esther, when she went in front of the king to save her own people. Courage. And when David was faced with the giant Goliath. Courage. These people faced frightening situations that required them to show strength when it was very difficult to do so. And our story for today is another example of people who had courage in the face of danger. You see, Pharaoh had issued an executive order. All Hebrew boys were to be killed by being thrown into the Nile. And there was a Hebrew woman who had recently had a baby boy. She had been hiding him for several months until she knew she could hide him no longer. So she devised a plan to keep him safe. And because of her courage, the situation turned out better than even she could have imagined. She knew she needed to comply with the Pharaoh's order. So she put her son in the Nile. Actually, she placed him in a basket first before she set him adrift in the river. Sneaky, yet courageous. And can you imagine the amount of courage she had to have to do that? To trust that her son would be okay in that basket in the river. So she placed him in the basket and she let go of the basket at the water's edge. And then she stepped away and trusted God. She was a picture of courage in the face of fear and opposition. And then this brings us to the baby's sister, Miriam. She had been the one to help her mother around the house and probably attended her at his birth. She probably rocked this little boy to help him sleep and helped her mother conceal his cries. She would have witnessed her scared mother placing her child in that basket in the water. Miriam showed amazing courage as she ducked in and out of the reeds, keeping watch, making sure that he was safe in that basket as he floated down the river. Can you picture her running alongside the swift moving water of that river as she kept her eyes on him, securing his safety? And when he stopped in front of the Egyptian princess, Miriam had the courage to speak up, being the catalyst for reuniting mother and son. Which brings us to that Egyptian princess, Pharaoh's own daughter, a young woman who had grown up around this tyrannical ruler. She just happened to be bathing in the river and heard this innocent baby cry as he was floating by. She would have immediately recognized this child as a Hebrew, and she knew what her father's order had been, but she could not resist the cries of a sweet little baby. So she chose to pull little Moses out of the water and was able to use her power and privilege and courage to not only save him, but raise him as her own. Life came when death was expected. Moses' mother thought he would surely be found as she tried desperately to hide him. Yet he lived. She thought he'd drown when placed in the river, and yet he lived. And then she thought he'd die at the hands of the Egyptian woman, and yet his life was spared when her heart was touched at the sound of his cries. And then the greatest shock of all. The Egyptian princess defies the most powerful man in the world by taking the child of his enemy into his own house and raising him as her own. Talk about courage. But what about us? What about what we are experiencing right now? How are we to have the courage in the face of so much fear and grief and so much unraveling of ourselves and our world? As the writing of this message, there has been 393,000 deaths in the United States due to coronavirus, and over 2 million in the whole world. The amount of grief and anguish people all around us are experiencing is unbelievable. Initially, many of us did not know anyone who had contracted the virus, but that's certainly not the case now. And with the different variants, COVID-19 seems to be more highly contagious than ever before. In fact, I saw a statistic that said early on, 1 in 300 people would get it. But now that number has jumped to 1 in 5. Staggering, to say the least. And where is God? Some may ask. Where is God in all this? I can confidently claim that God is most certainly in the midst of all this suffering with us, standing by our side, holding our hands, wiping our tears, and loving us more than ever. And how can I boldly claim this? Because it's right there in our scripture. In every single page of the Bible, God is there. In some stories, God's presence is felt or even seen very actively, while in some, God seems to work from behind the scenes. God was with Moses' mother as she placed him in the water. God was with Miriam as she skipped along the shore, keeping an eye on her brother. And God was with Pharaoh's daughter as she made a choice that day and stood up for what she knew was right. Our God is a God that has promised to be with us throughout all of life's troubles, to never leave us or abandon us. So although we may sometimes feel alone, God is always with us. God is with us in the presence of others as they tend to us while we're sick or grieving. God is with us as we choose to speak up for the rights of others. And God is with us when we dig deep down to find the courage to stand up to fear and oppression. Our stories may not seem grand. We're not hiding babies. We're not parting the Red Sea. We're not fighting mighty armies. Battling lions, standing up to kings. But we can see in this story how God used several unlikely women to accomplish God's work. These women all had reason to give way to fear. But they did not, as they displayed amazing courage. May the same be said of us. Amen. Let us hear another song.
Please join us in singing Control. Obsessions, I'm gonna lay them all down.
King of heaven was made. So this world has lost its grip on me.
At this point in our service, we give thanks. We give thanks for those of you who are continuing to support the mission and ministry of First Lutheran Church inside these walls and outside in our community. And I know things are different this year. Things have been different for 10 months. And we've got an event coming up that we all look forward to. Super Bowl Sunday, the S-O-U-P-E-R Bowl. I know some of y'all look forward to the football game as well. But we look forward to our version of the Super Bowl with kids who dress up in their jerseys and they greet you at the door collecting money to give to those in need. We have to do things a little differently this year. So we have a very special promo video to explain what we're doing.
If you care about the Super Bowl, want to join a team, dreams can come true. Join the FLC team for the Super Bowl of Karen.
Let's tackle hunger together and score big with monetary donations for the UNCG Spartan Open Pantry.
Due to the pandemic, we were unable to host our annual Spartones holiday concert and food drive, but we can help now by donating to this local charity.
The UNCG Spartan Open Pantry provides much-needed food for struggling students and staff, and the end of the month can often be a challenge for some of them. The FLC Endowment Committee has already pledged $500. Can the congregation match these funds in just a few days?
We will collect donations starting Friday, January the 15th through Sunday, January the 31st. You can donate online at www.firstlutheran.com or send a check to the church with Super Bowl for Caring in the memo line.
Time to score a touchdown together in the fight against hunger.
Now that's a cause I can get behind. Please support our Super Bowl for Caring any way that you can. Thank you. Let us now turn our hearts to our prayers. I know it seems these days we have many more than we used to have. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, today we long to be held. We long to be held by your unbreakable, unshakable, and infinite love. We long to be covered by you, that we can take a breath and step away from the chaos happening in our world. And yet, we know that we too must do the work to make our community and world a place filled with your love and your justice. Remind us, Lord, that this is your world and that no matter what happens here to any of us, we always remain yours and belong fully and completely to you. We ask that you help us to embody you as we find a way to spread your justice in this world and in all of us who remain so unraveled and broken. Lord of the journey,
show us the way.
Holy Lord, although we long to forget the events happening in our world, we still choose to lift up all of the feelings we feel in our bodies to you. Our sadness, our anger, our helplessness, our confusion, our disgust, our desire to change ourselves and those around us, and our wish for hope. All of these feelings and many others we lift up to you and ask that you take them as we also continue to work through them ourselves. We pray that we and those around us may have understanding as we all work through our feelings differently. We ask that you help us to find a way to sit with our emotions while also sitting with you. Lord of the journey,
Show us the way.
Holy God, there is so much. So many things are happening in our world that we cannot wrap our minds around. And so that we ask that you may help us, that you may hold us as we cannot hold ourselves, that we may find you in all of the little places and all the little things we have to do in any given week. We ask that you walk with us and that we may find little pieces of comfort and joy throughout our week. Even when we are not strong and have so little to give, we know that you have so much to give. We ask that you may be the comforting presence to each of those in our community, that your unshakable and infinite love will carry us through and hold us today and always. Lord of the journey,
show us the way.
Loving God, today our hearts ache with those who are experiencing pain and suffering. We pray for comfort as many of us continue to experience losses of all kinds, the lives of so many, broken relationships, jobs and sources of income, as well as the anniversaries of so many losses, which we remember and continue to mourn. So we pause now for a moment to add names to our prayers, those who are connected within this community of faith. We pray for Matt and Christine, Howard, Catherine, Grace, and Larry, B, Melissa, Rita, Bob, Laura, Kim, and Steve. We pray for Elaine, Jan, Art, Jessica, David, and Jenny. For Glenn, Chris, Brian, Sylvia, Austin, Will, and all those that we now say aloud. Lead us, Lord, to help bring them comfort in their days of distress. Lord of the journey,
show us the way.
We now join our prayers as we pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I said earlier we are celebrating communion today, something that brings us together as a family, as siblings in Christ. So please gather whatever you have available to you and join me in the words for communion. God seeks us to be in communion with us and wants us to be in communion with one another. Through Jesus, God drew closer to us by living among us. We remember how long ago Jesus broke bread with his disciples and showed us the way to reconciliation by asking us to share our bread with one another in remembrance of his own example. Through the broken bread, we participate in and become the body of Christ. In like manner, Jesus took the cup filled with the fruit of the vine that sustains and links us to one another. Through the cup of blessing, we participate in and become the new life of Christ in the world. The bread and fruit we partake nourishes us that we may nourish others. Through this sacrament of Holy Communion, we affirm that we are committed to Christ's way of love and peace by our motives, thoughts, actions, and practices in this world. We acknowledge that we are one community made by God. We dedicate ourselves to make the body of Christ real in this world and throughout our life as a community of the faithful.
Amen.
Amen. As you take your bread and wine or juice at home, remember that it was given in love for you. Join me in our blessing, and then we will have our last song. When our plans fall apart,
may God weave us together with love.
When life falls apart, our unraveling is an end, but not the end. The weaving helps us embody the promise of the great weaver, that our loose ends can be woven into something new and beautiful. Coming unraveled and being woven back together is not linear or predictable. It is an ongoing process in which we bear witness to both spaces at once. There is always a piece of us that exists between the unraveling and the weaving. And God meets us there every time. Amen.
And now join us for the final song of the day, Sound of the Saints.
Oh, I love to hear the song of creation, the wind and the rhythm of rain. Oh, the thunder, it speaks of your power, but there's something in the sound of the saints. I've been washed in the roar of the ocean, in the echoes of cave, and the trees of the field, they clap their hands. There's something in the sound of the saints, from the lips of those you save. A redemption song will rise, with a sound so full it cracks the sky. Oh,
what a wonderful song from some of our saints. I certainly miss the rest of you saints up here on the stage singing with them, and I look forward to that one day. Thank you all for your presence with us today, my siblings in Christ. We are one family. So now go with Christ and go as Christ to love and serve God's world. Thanks be to God.